Good evening. It's good to see everybody. We are out of town this week on vacation with our family, so we're not having any midweek Bible study at church, but I wanted to share with you this evening. So sharing from the front porch of our house in Surf City. I mean, glad to have the opportunity to do that. Just want to say a couple of things that in terms of some announcements. Sunday school and worship, our regular times this coming weekend. Invite you to always be a part of that. We are having both of those live at our church. Sunday school begins at 9:30, worship at 10:45, always grateful, thankful for everybody that's taking part in any way with that. Very thankful and grateful for the progress that we're making with our building project, and we're coming close to wrapping that up within the next couple of weeks, and so we're very very grateful for that as well. A lot of folks around us having needs, those being impacted, of course, by the virus, both by the sickness itself and maybe even more so by the various things that have been done, the shutdowns and all, that are having so much of an impact on people's lives. We pray for our teachers and other school leaders as they're making preparations to try to begin school in a few weeks now in some very unusual situations, but we're grateful for them and the work that they do to try to make this happen in spite of the difficulties that are there, and so we're much in prayer for them. Let's pray for our nation. Pray for our president and the others that lead us, our governors and those that lead us. Here in our state and other states, they have difficult decisions and choices to make, and it's very easy for us to criticize, and sometimes we ought to maybe be a little more careful to just pray for them and encourage them in the things they do. I think it'd make a tremendous difference in our nation if we all would seek to find ways that we can cooperate and we can support those that are in positions of leadership. We'll have the opportunity to vote few months now. If we don't like the ones we got, we can vote some different ones in or out or whatever we do. And then whoever's chosen, that's one of the privileges of living in America. We have the privilege to choose our leaders, and that's something we ought to be very grateful for, and we ought to be careful to pray for them. We are going to share in just a word of prayer now. We want to be mindful of the many around us that are so many that are in need, especially in our church there. We continue to lift Miss Diane as she's going through the treatments with cancer, and she's had some tests done. We're just praying for all the results from that and for things as she moves forward. We continue to pray for the others that we have, for Belva and Dickie. Pray for both of them. Continue to pray for Danny Evans as he's recovering from the surgery that he had, for Miss Diane as she's continuing from the surgery that she had. Brother Richie Wall there, glad to know that he's back home, and just many, many around. I always hate to start mentioning names because I know I overlook somebody, and I don't mean to do that at all. But we've had some families that have lost loved ones, and certainly we want to pray for them as well. And so let's share together in a word of prayer now. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful for your goodness to us, the thing that makes it possible for us to have life itself. And we thank you for this day and the blessing that it's been, and for the time that we have now as we come to the end of this day together around your word. I pray, Lord, that you'll bless as we open your word and help it to be real to us and help it to be shared in such a way to make a difference in someone's life. We lift these various ones in our prayer. There's so many around us that have needs. When we lift each in our prayer, you know every situation, every circumstance. Lord, we pray if it could be your will, where there's sickness, for complete healing to take place, where there's heartache, for comfort to be there for them, where there are needs, whatever kind of needs there might be, that they might be met. And most of all, that in all things, that we would choose to trust you and to seek to follow you in all the things that we do. We pray for our church. We thank you, Lord, for the good things you're doing in our church, and pray that you'll continue to bless as we seek together to be your kingdom's work in the place that you've given us, an opportunity in ways that we can to lift the load and the burden of one that's carrying, and to do the things we can to always seek to draw people toward you. Forgive us of our sinfulness, for our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. This evening, I want to turn to, it'll be several passages of Scripture, but we're going to begin in the book of Revelation and the fourth chapter. Last week, we studied together. Last Wednesday night, we talked together about the rewards that are given, the crowns, various crowns that are listed in Scripture. There's five different specific crowns that are mentioned in the New Testament that are given to Christian people. And this is not the reward of salvation. This is a reward in salvation. And so there are rewards that are given to those for their labors, for their work as Christians. And so once we're saved, then we're given the task of serving the Lord in various ways we can. And this is the blessing that comes to that. And we looked at those different crowns and how they were presented. And one of the things that we mentioned there was how that in heaven, the picture seen there of the 24 elders, which we believe represent the raptured saints. They represent all the Christians who have been raptured into heaven. The very beginning of the fourth chapter, John says that he heard a voice saying, "Come up hither." And we believe in the book of Revelation that this represents the rapture of the church. And when the church is taken into heaven, then the rest of the book of Revelation is about something that's going to happen in the future after that event. We don't know when that event is. The best that we know and understand, that's the next event on God's calendar. It'll be the rapture of the church. And when the church is taken out, then these heavenly the events will begin to happen. And the first thing that John saw was he was placed in a place where he saw the throne of God and saw God sitting on it. And we saw how that the crowns that were given were placed at the feet of Jesus as an act of worship. And so tonight I want us to go a step further, following up in that same thing, and to think about worship in heaven. You know, we, most of us that have been in church all of our lives, we have what we call, we'll go on Sunday and we'll have Sunday school, and then we'll have a worship service, or sometimes we just call it worship. And people will have a group that leads in that. There's a worship leader, maybe a praise band or a worship choir, and all these terms that we use, and all of them are built around that idea of worship. Well, I want us to look at three specific instances in the book of Revelation that mentions worship, and look at how they represent for us three things that we can praise and worship God for. And so we're going to begin reading in chapter 4, and I'm going to start in the ninth verse there. Now, what's been described is that there were beasts that were around the throne, and that term "beast" is not the is not what we think about, because most time when we think about a beast, we think about something that is a terrifying thing or something that is fearful. But these are not that. It's just a description that they are beings, and they had specific characteristics, and they all it says were constantly around the throne worshiping God. And so we're going to pick up in verse 9, and when these beasts give glory, this is the fourth chapter now of the book of Revelation, verse 9, and when these beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that is on the throne who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders, now that's the raptured saints, fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever and cast their crowns before the throne. Now, that's where we looked last week. But notice then the next verse, it says, saying, thou art worthy. And I want to stop right there for just a minute before we even finish that verse. Because when we speak about worship, the first thought has to be, is that which we worship worthy of our worship? There's a song that we sing. It's one of my very favorite songs that we sing called Worthy of Worship. And it talks about the characteristics of God and his son Christ that calls us to worship him because he is worthy of our worship. Now, if you're not careful in your life each day, you may find that you are that you place things on a throne of worship that is beyond what it ought to be. In other words, sometimes we'll even use, and I know people don't mean it, in a disrespectful or a sacrilegious kind of way, but we'll say, I just worship my little grandchild. Well, you love your grandchild greatly, but you shouldn't worship your grandchild. Or I worship my wife or my husband. Or some people worship their job or their car or their house or their boat or that new diamond ring that they got or whatever. And what it means is this is something that we have placed such great value on that we're choosing to worship. And that's a wrong term to use, because worship is reserved specifically for God. He alone is worthy of our worship. And we're going to notice tonight what it says here. It says that they said, "Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created." And so we see here that the first thing in heaven that's the characteristic that God that causes him to be worshipped by us is because he is the creator. He is the creator. You go back and the Bible begins. We're at the end of the Bible here in the book of Revelation. You go back, the Bible begins Genesis 1:1, and it says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." There's a picture there of the beginning of everything. Before God introduces anything else about his word and how we're to relate to him, he starts by saying that he created everything that is in this world. So when you have something and you say that's mine, it's not really yours. It is something that's loaned to you. You're a steward of it for a period of time. And very quickly, time will pass and I'll pass away or you'll pass away. And that we say is mine, somebody else will then lay claim to and say that it's theirs. And so that the possession we have is temporary. The possession he has is permanent because he is created. And the Old Testament begins with that. But if you move over in the New Testament, when John begins his gospel, he begins a little different than the others. There's not a nativity story here, but there's the story of the presence of God. John chapter 1, the gospel of John chapter 1, beginning in verse 1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not." Now, what he says here is everything that is in this world was created by Jesus Christ. He was the person of the Trinity that was used under God's command. God the Father commanded him, and he followed it, and it said everything was made by him. When it says in the beginning was the Word, that word is capitalized W, and that's a reference to the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything was made by him. And so the beginning of worship here in the book of Revelation is that these 24 elders who are in heaven and who have been given crowns, they fall down and they worship him, and they say, "You're worthy to be worshiped because you have created all things." Well, that's the first reason for worship, or the first instance of worship. Well, if we go to the second one, you just move over to the next chapter, to chapter 5, and you pick up in verse 8. And it says here, now this is after it tells us at the beginning of chapter 5 that there was in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book. And this book is written, the future of what's going to take place. All the events that are recorded in the book of Revelation are in this book that was in the hand of him who was on the throne. That was God. And it says that there was nobody who was worthy to open it until one came forth. It's described him, and this is the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, I want to back up and spend just a minute reading that. If you look in verse 4, beginning in verse 4, "And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said to me, 'Weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the 7 seals thereof.' And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the 4 beasts and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb, as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, and that which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. This is the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's placed here. Well, then move down and pick up in verse 8. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, listen to this, thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by the blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. He has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. And I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beast, and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power, and riches, and wisdom, and strength, and honor, and glory, and blessing. And so this second worship that comes here, that's presented to us, the 24 elders, the angels that are there, everything that is around the throne falls down and worships. And in this case, the worship is to the Lord Jesus Christ. And why is it? It says that you are worthy to take the book. You're worthy to be worshiped. Why? Because you have redeemed us. So we see him first worshiped as a creator. Secondly, we see him worshiped as our redeemer. Now, the word redeem is a special word. I've used the example several times through the years in different messages. I remember when I was a child, my mother used to collect S&H green stamps. Some of you old enough to remember that. Used to go to the grocery store and they'd give these stamps, and she would come home and we'd lick them and put them in books. And when you got a book full, you could go to the S&H green stamp redemption center and you could redeem your books for some useless stuff. I mean, they had things that you could collect books forever and get something that's worth about $3, but you redeemed it. It had some value. Sometimes you'll see now a lot of people clip coupons. I don't clip coupons, but I do save them. If you go to the grocery store and buy something and they'll hand you a coupon, I fold it up and stick it in my wallet. Next time I go, if I can remember, I pull it out and use it. Sometimes different companies that we purchase things from in our business, they'll send you a coupon that's worth something, and you can redeem it the next time that you purchase something. And so redemption is the idea that you take something and you pay a price for it. Now, when we think about the Redeemer here, we're thinking about our souls redeemed and saved from our sins and from the punishment for that sin. If you turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. They are you are his. You don't belong to you anymore. Your body belongs to God. You're the temple of the Holy Spirit because he bought you. He redeemed you. And when he purchased you, he paid a dear price on the cross of Calvary. His precious blood was shed there to purchase us. Multitudes of different passages that I could refer to there. But we move on. But there is one I want to look at, and that is Ephesians chapter 2, and Paul continues thinking about this. And notice in chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, that's Satan, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. It says, you were dead, and he has quickened you. That is, he's made you alive. He's redeemed you. Among whom also we all had once our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But I love this. Chapter 2 begins, and you get to verse 4, and it says, but God. I'm telling you what, the number of times when you're reading along and Paul describes our sinful condition, and then he puts in that term, but God. That, it makes you want to stop and shout if you're a shouting person. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you're saved, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. How was it that the 24 elders were seated around the throne? Because it says he hath quickened us and hath raised us up together to make us to sit in heavenly places with him. And so the idea that they begin with the worship to him because he's the creator of everything. Secondly, they worship him because he is the redeemer. He's the one who has placed us in a situation where we have the opportunity to join those around the throne. Well, then the third worship that I want to look at, if you move over a couple of chapters, you come over to chapter 11, Revelation chapter 11, and begin in reading with verse 16. And the 24 elders, here again we see the picture of the rapture church, the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshiped God. Now, why do they worship this time? Verse 17, saying, we give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and was and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned. And the nations were angry, and thy wrath is come in the time of the dead, that they should be judged, and that thou shouldest give reward unto thy servants the prophets, and to the saints, and them that fear thy name, small and great, and shouldest destroy them which destroy the earth. And the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and an earthquake and great hail. So here we see that he is worshipped because he is worshipped as king and as judge. First of all, it says that they worship him because he has come to reign. He has come to reign. His reign is a part of the reward that he gives. The scripture tells us, and if you read on here, and we won't spend time with that tonight, though, but you find that there's going to be a 1,000-year period of time, what we call the millennial reign of Christ. And during that millennial reign, it tells us that the saints will reign with Christ on the earth. There will be situations of all kinds of different ways that the saints are a part of the work that's being done by Christ here on this earth. And there'll be a 1,000-year reign of peace. During that period of time, Satan is going to be bound. The demons of hell are going to be bound. And there'll be total and complete peace on this earth. Now, a lot of people, and like I say, we're not going to spend a lot of time on that, but a lot of people say, you know, if we could only clean up all the problems in the world, if we could give everybody a nice house and everybody plenty of money and plenty of food and plenty of clothes and all that, just get rid of all the problems that there are here on the earth, that then everything would be fine. Well, there's two situations that prove that's not true. The first one is the Garden of Eden. When Adam and Eve were placed there, there's never been anything that's more complete than the description of paradise that they see there, because they had everything. I mean, you and I, sometimes we say, man, if I could just have everything I want and not have to work for it. That's exactly who they were. That's where they were. They were given everything. In fact, sometimes we find people, you know, are taking a trip somewhere and it's described as paradise. Well, you've never seen real paradise, but that's where they were. And yet, in spite of that, when God said, you have the privilege of use of everything, completely enjoy it, have dominion over it, control over it, but there's one thing you can't do. And they didn't last 30 minutes. I mean, it was, and you and I are the same way. There's just no way, excuse me, there's no way that we avoid that, which we're not supposed to do. There's something about us that causes us to turn that direction. Well, the same thing's going to happen here, because this 1,000-year reign with the devil removed, everything will be as perfect as it can be. And yet, during this period of time, there's going to be people that live for that period. And we don't know exactly all the circumstances of it, but we do know that at the end of that 1,000 years, that Satan is turned loose again. And the reason that he's turned loose is that he will come back into this world to try to deceive and tempt and trap those people who have lived during this 1,000-year period of time. People are born. People live. They live their lives in all kinds of ways. They've lived in absolute perfection and peace under the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet there will be many that when Satan is loose, they will turn away from him. And so the idea that just the right environment is going to fix everything is completely untrue. And so we find here, though, that the 24 elders fall down and worship him, and they say, "We worship you because you, first of all, are king." When you come to reign, and when he comes to reign, he gives the rewards. Last week we looked at the judgment seat of Christ and how that works together, and we won't go back through that again tonight. But the judgment seat of Christ is an event where saved people. If you're saved, when you die, you're going to heaven. And when the rapture of the church takes place, if you're alive, you'll be taken to heaven. If you have died, your body will be resurrected and you'll be taken to heaven. But when that takes place, then every person who's ever lived that's saved will stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an answer for how they live their life. You see, if you think that getting saved means I'm going to heaven and from then on I can do like I please, that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that we are accountable for how we live, and our rewards that are given to us are the rewards for what we've done as a Christian. Being going to heaven is not a reward for anything I can do. That's a result of something Christ has done on the cross. But the crown that I will have, the rewards that I will have, is given to us, and at the judgment seat of Christ that will be given. And so that's the first half of what they honor him and worship him for. But the second part is that he now comes also to sit as a righteous judge. Now, I'm going to tell you, you're hearing a whole lot nowadays about justice. Every time you turn around, you hear somebody using that term justice. And, you know, we all want to be treated fairly. We all want to be treated the same under the law. And I understand people that have been mistreated or placed in situations. There's no excuse for it. Never any defense for it at all. But when we really come down to talking about our eternity, I don't want to be treated fairly. I want to be treated through the grace of God. The grace of God gives me salvation. If I got what I wanted, I would be separated from, if I got what I deserved, I would be separated from God forever in a place called hell. So I'm thankful that I don't get what I deserve. Instead, I get what he grants to me as grace. And if I'm willing to accept it, that grace comes to me. Well, the judgment, though, of those who have refused that is that now they stand to be judged, and they will be judged at what's called the white throne judgment, where every lost person will stand. Well, the beginning of judgment, though, takes place before that, because what we see here is a description of the way that this judgment is going to take place. Let me read a couple of verses for you. Revelation chapter 19 and beginning in verse 11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Now we go back excuse me, but go back to the passage we looked at in John, the Gospel of John chapter 1, where it says, in the beginning was the Word. Here he is again, the Word of God. Verse 14, and the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. That's you and me. That's you and me, brother. We're going to be a part of that army. And out of his mouth, this is out of Jesus, out of his mouth, goeth forth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I got a tickle in my throat there. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Verse 17, and I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowl that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. Listen to this, that ye may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. What he says here is that all the people that remain on the earth are going to be slain. They're going to die. And as they die, they will die at the hand of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it says there's going to be a great army coming behind. But friend, we're not coming to fight. We're coming to watch. We're going to be spectators only because the battle is won. And it says there's a sharp sword that came out of his mouth. That is the Word of God. The Bible tells us that the Bible is the sword that you and I use. And we temporarily use it as a weapon against evil and against Satan in this world. He will use it in that moment as a weapon of judgment. And so in that passage in chapter 19, now then you move over to chapter 20 and begin up, pick up in verse 11. And I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in those books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and the death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them, and they were judged every man according to their works, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. You see, the most important decision you'll ever make in your life is to trust Christ as your Savior. Because when you trust Him as your Savior, your name is written in the book of life. And when your name is written in the book of life, it can never be removed. And there'll be a time when you will die or you will be taken in the rapture, whichever happens. And you will stand before God. And the only decision that's going to make any difference, I don't care what you did. I don't care if you sang 1,000 solos or preached 1,000,000 sermons. Whoever you are, any good deeds you did, everything, all those things are wonderful. But the only thing that's going to make a difference in where you're going to spend eternity is when that book is opened and it's determined whether it's there. You know, I got a feeling there's going to be some people. They're going to be standing there just wondering, man, I wonder if my name's in there or not. Well, let me tell you, friend, I don't wonder about it. I know my name is written there. I have no doubt about it. I live my life every day based on the firm belief and understanding that because I've trusted Christ as my Savior, my name is written in the book of life. You can know that same thing right now. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, right this minute, right where you are, I don't care what you're doing or where you are. If you're sitting at home, if you're riding down the road, maybe later you come and watch this. It makes no difference when it is. Right now, all you need to do is just simply say, Lord, I know that I'm a sinner. And I understand that because of my sin, I deserve to be punished and be separated from God forever in a place called hell. But I believe Christ died on the cross to pay for my sins. I'm sorry for my sins. And I ask you to forgive me, come into my heart, save me, and then help me to live for you each day. You pray that prayer and you mean it, your name will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, there's one more passage you want to look at real quick before we close. If you back over into the Old Testament, to the book of Isaiah, chapter 11, beginning in verse 1, "And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, and shall make him of quick understanding in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge after the sight of his eyes, neither reprove after the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove the equity for the meek of the earth, and shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked." What it says right here is that when Christ sits as a judge, he sits as an absolute righteous judge. He has every right to judge. He has every basis to judge. And there's no crookedness in this court. There's nobody earning any special favors because they know somebody or because they slid a little money under the table. He says he does not judge after the sight of his eyes. In other words, he doesn't judge by outward appearance. But with righteousness shall he judge. And it's a picture here of the complete righteousness of the one who comes. And so what we've seen here is that in heaven, there is worship. And there are three specific worships we mentioned. First of all, that he's worshiped because he is the creator. Secondly, he's worshiped because he is the redeemer. Third, he is worshiped because he is king and judge. Now, friend, I don't know when that day is going to be. None of us know when the Lord's going to return. We don't know when the rapture of the church is going to take place. As I said, that's the next event on God's calendar. There's nothing that has to happen before that takes place, but we don't know when it's going to happen. Anybody ever tells you they know, they're probably being less than honest with you. They really don't know. The Bible tells us nobody knows, but it does tell us that this is a sure thing that's going to take place. And if you're not prepared, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, I pray that before this night is over, that you'll make things right with him. Make your destiny for eternity completely settled. Allow him to come into your heart and to save you. But more than that, allow him also to be Lord of your life. Everything you're doing, every day that you live. We were talking today as we were sitting out on the beach visiting there, and we were talking about how a person can never have real joy and fulfillment in their life until Christ is the center of their life. There's so many people that are trying to live their lives chasing all the things there are in this world, and they may be temporarily happy for just a moment, but that happiness is temporary. You can only know true joy when you trust Christ as your Savior and when you allow him to be the Lord of your life. I pray you've done that. I pray you will do that. I pray for the remainder of the week that you'll have a great week, that God will bless you in the things you do. We look forward to sharing some additional time here with our family on vacation, and then looking forward Sunday morning to be back. I'll be back there for Sunday school worship service. Looking forward to that, sharing with our folks. If you don't have a church home, or maybe your church right now for whatever reason is not meeting, we'd certainly welcome you to come be a part of our fellowship there at Micro. We are meeting in person. We're being careful about the things that we do, asking everybody to in ways that they can to be clean and safe, of course, and to distance and all those kinds of things. If you feel that you need to, and it's the right thing to do to wear a mask, that's absolutely fine. We'll be happy for you to do that. But we'd love to see you. If you can't be there, if you choose not to, we again will invite you to join with us Sunday morning. We'll be live streaming our worship service. Our Sunday school lesson will be broadcast at other times. It's not live, but we'll be live streaming our worship service, and we encourage you to be a part of that. Have a great week. Let's close in prayer. God, we thank you again for the privilege we have to gather around your word. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the assurance that it is, and for the assurance that we can have that we hold within our hands a perfect treasure that you've left for us. We don't have to doubt it. We don't have to question it. We simply read it, trust it, believe it, follow it. And we know that if we do that, we're never going to be disappointed. I pray for each one that's listening in any kind of way, the temporary circumstances, problems they may be dealing with. I pray, Lord, for you just to meet each one. I pray for every family that's represented, for every mom and dad, every child. And I pray that in every circumstance, that you will work, that you will bless, that you will encourage, that people be drawn closer to you, and that as we live for you each day, we'll have the privilege to make a difference in other people's lives. Forgive us of our sinfulness, for our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.